Hi, everybody. So I am sincerely hoping to help you guys change the world with this talk. I'm not going to talk about my projects and my theories. I want to give you guys something that you can do to change the world, but I've only got 15 minutes. So we're going to try. And I think actually that's good because you know what? We really don't have a lot of time if we're going to make the changes that we need to make to bring about that sustainable future we've all been talking about. We need to find the intervention right now that's going to start moving things into motion, and we need to work together to get that intervention going. So what is it? Is it going to be biofuels, algae, terraforming, space colonization? Well, we're probably going to wind up doing a lot, if not all of these things, and probably many of the people in this room are already working on these. But if we really want to change the world, if we really want to shift over the next 20 years to make that sustainable future possible, we've got to get better at doing something that we've been not so good at all this time as we think about sustainability. And that is telling great stories. Because only stories have the ability to shift societies of billions of people in a generation. Nothing else can. No technology, no innovation can change lives, can change values, can change habits and activities the way that stories have. Now, how do I know this works? Because we've seen it happen already. It happened in the last century. You see, in the early 20th century, human beings, and especially Americans, were valuing things like thrift and modesty and saving. And that came out of these experiences with the Protestant work ethic and the Great Depression. We valued using and consuming less. And at that time, we did consume about half the number of resources that we did today. But there was a storm brewing. Things were about to shift. These values were about to change 180 degrees. And if you care about sustainability, you got to look at a moment when values and behaviors changed 180 degrees, because that's what we're looking to do right here, right now. So what happened? Well, our myths changed. You see, a myth is a special kind of story. And I call it the kind of cultural DNA of a society. A myth tells us what's important. It tells us what we value and how we should behave, and it does this by combining four key elements. And every society that anthropologists have ever studied have built themselves on myths. So here's the myth of Genesis, right? It provides us explanation, an idea of how the world works. God created the world in 7 days. Now, it gives us meaning. We don't just listen and say, that's interesting. We say, well, what does that mean for me? Well, it means that this is God's world and we should obey him. Story. It doesn't take place in your neighbor's backyard. It doesn't take place 10 seconds ago. It's not just an anecdote or something interesting. It lives in the world of symbols. It's more like a dream. It speaks fluently in symbology. So the Garden of Eden is long ago and far away. It takes us away from our everyday, and it gives us rituals, ways to play out this story in our own lives, right? The Bible gives us thousands of ways to apply this story to our own behavior. You bring these four things together, and you've got this myth. And that is what gives us a sense of who we are and how we connect and how we should behave and what's important. But we started losing our traditional myths. In the middle of the 20th century, we entered for what the first time people felt was a myth gap, a society that didn't have these shared meaning stories. Maybe it was the emergence of science. Science gave us lots of new explanation of the world, but it didn't really give us the meaning or the story or the ritual. It simply burst apart many of our old myths. Entertainment exploded onto the scene. Everyone was suddenly sharing and watching movies. But movies don't really give us rituals and not really meaning. They're just really entertainment. They're just stories. So we started drifting. And Carl Jung at the time in the 1920s said that we may be becoming the first society ever to not have shared myths. And psychologists like Freud felt that maybe these wars were breaking out because we didn't have these meaning stories anymore. But then, right around the end of World War II, marketers started doing something extremely clever. They started telling stories, but not just any stories. When they moved away from product pitches, just talking about attributes and price and features, and started telling real stories, they started creating new myths. Let's see how it works. Okay, here's the Marlboro man. He's still the most famous product pitch man of all time. He never said a single word. He came out at a time when they had this great new idea, filtered cigarettes, but not just filtered cigarettes for men. Because before then, filtered cigarettes were only for women. Nobody woke up and said, I want a filtered cigarette for men, but Marlboro wanted to pass them along. So what did they do? They didn't talk about the great taste. They didn't talk about the health effects. They simply showed this guy. They connected us to a story that we knew, a story about our frontier past, and they gave us explanation. Here's a new way to smoke, filtered cigarettes for men, simple. Meaning, if you smoke this cigarette, you will have the identity of a rugged cowboy. This is not just an idle fantasy that they had. We know that you pull out a pack of Marlboro Reds and you're saying something about yourself. Story. Nobody walked by this billboard and said, oh, don't buy those cigarettes, that guy's not real. We know he's an actor, but it doesn't matter. It doesn't have to be literally true. Myths take place in another realm. And ritual, is there any doubt about how to live the story out in your own life? Doing this transforms society. Things that were never before thought possible, like identifying yourself with the brands that you buy, became commonplace. Consuming rather than saving became the highest ideal. Shopping became our favorite leisure activity. The world changed because our myths changed, and marketers created those myths. Now that's a little scary, but it's true, and it shifted in a single generation our life ways, our consumption patterns, our behaviors. That's amazing. This is what they did, but they also created the sustainability crisis that we find ourselves in right now. So we need to copy what they did, but to turn that crisis around. And there's a way to do it, because the marketers of the past use storytelling in a specific way. Like any story, you've got a protagonist, you've got the consumer. But they cast the consumer as the sort of helpless damsel in distress, with the brand as the hero, arriving on the scene just in time to save the day from a world filled with anxiety. One of the most famous early storytelling campaigns was called Sad Edna. You don't see it anymore, of course, but it's for Listerine. They were introducing a new product, and they showed this 30-year-old spinster. She was still not married at 30, and she would never be married because she had bad breath. No one even really knew about the problem of halitosis, the silent disease in America, but as soon as they heard about it, they ran out to buy the hero product, Listerine, that would save them. More recently, I don't know if you've seen Whopper Freakout, but people go into a Burger King and they ask for the Whopper, and when they hear that it's not available anymore, they fall apart, they start to cry, they try to trash the store. Without their favorite brands, they're nothing. The brand is the hero, and they're kind of the losers until they get in contact with the brand. These stories have a very simple moral. To be a good citizen is to be a good consumer. I'm sure you all remember when 9/11, George Bush said, what you can do is go out and shop. And we all nodded our heads, because 50 years of this kind of advertising makes us believe that the brands are the heroes and we're the helpless damsel in distress. And that's how marketing and advertising have been run throughout the broadcast era, throughout the time when we have no choice but to take in the advertisements that are given to us over the last 100 years. We don't decide what's advertised to us. We watch our TV show, or we look at our billboards. That's the story they tell us. But we know that broadcast era is coming to a close. We know that what happens now is you put out an ad like that Dove ad, and you need to partner with your audiences. You gotta get them excited. You gotta get them passing it around. It's a survival of the fittest landscape. When we put out the story of Stuff, we had no idea that 30 million people would one day see it, but we've put out other products that we thought were better and no one wanted to watch. People are choosing now what messages and brands they pass along. And it's becoming a survival of the fittest landscape. Now, is this kind of message what's going to thrive in this new survival of the fittest landscape? Well, probably not. Why? Well, Joseph Campbell studied what works in oral traditions, societies that are that survival of the fittest landscape, where you have to pass messages to get them to work. And he was looking for a specific pattern, something that would tell him, what do all cultures have in common? What kind of stories do human beings prefer? And he found a pattern. He called it the hero's journey. And you see it in Hollywood films, and you see it in books, and you see it everywhere. You'll recognize it when I tell it to you if you haven't heard about it already. You have this helpless outsider living in a broken world. She has deeper values, but she doesn't know how to live them out. She actually has no power. Then she meets a mentor. This is the Obi-Wan Kenobi character, the fairy godmother, who says, wait, so much more is possible. You could be the hero of this story. You can change the world. And the outsider, the hero-to-be says, not me, I have no power, I'm too busy, I'm too tired, I'm not the hero of the story, you got the wrong person. But the mentor creates a deep relationship with that person, with that hero, and sends her into this dangerous symbolic world of self-discovery. There she meets the source of the world's brokenness, and she seizes a treasure. She brings that treasure back to her world. But this doesn't make her the kind of hero that has more stuff or is more famous or becomes the queen of the world. It allows her to humbly help to create a better society. The stories that we prefer are stories about everyday people who actually step up and change the world. In other words, people listen to these stories, Campbell said, because they wanted to learn how to be heroes in their own lives, to make sacrifices, not to make themselves wealthier or have more status, but to help and heal the world. This is very different than the message that you are the helpless damsel in distress and we are the hero come to save the day. The stories that have persisted across all time tell a very different story about how much you can do to make your world a better place. And this is really good news for marketers and communicators who are trying to sell the idea of sustainability. We don't have to make it the easiest thing. We don't have to make it the most convenient thing. We can make it something, an interesting, exciting adventure that becomes our identity and is specifically about making a better world. We still see it everywhere, and we're seeing it more and more in marketing. There's now the moral of the story that people want to pass along when given the chance, and I've seen it so many times in my own work, and I think we've seen it in some of the stuff we've seen today, is stories where the consumer, the outsider, the helpless person, becomes a true citizen, gets empowered, and does something different, are the stories that if you want to go viral and you want to be heard, these are the kind of stories you need to be telling. And incidentally, these are the stories that can start to shift our society 180 degrees, just like we did a generation ago. So is it crazy not to just go and say, we're the most convenient, we're the best features, we'll take care of you? Well, of course not. You see, when we make our stories the hero and we make ourselves the mentor as communicators, taking them on a journey, we're doing what some of the best communicators have been doing all along. You see it with Nike, you see it with Obama, you see it with Apple. A generation ago, some brands quietly started showing you that you have the power, and we're here just to facilitate your greatness, not to be the hero of the story. But now, we need a new generation of sustainability communicators and entrepreneurs and experts to realize that the stories that we're telling are as important as the technologies and products that we're developing. We need to start asking ourselves, are we combining these four elements? Explanation, teaching people core truths about how the world works and will work in the future. Meaning, are we giving people a place in those stories that we're telling? Hopefully a place as hero, giving them something meaningful they can do. The earlier group was talking about authenticity. You can't call people to a heroic adventure without treating them with authenticity and transparency. We need to partner with our audiences, be real with them. We talked a lot about humor and emotion earlier in the videos we saw. You can't just blabber the facts. You've got to tell stories. Take them into a magic world where more is possible. Do what the Bible did and the Marlboro Man did. Make them see something outside of their own realm of experience. And then be clear about what real rituals can help change the world. As I've been talking about this and going around the world talking about encouraging people to tell stories, I've heard people asking for three stories that they want to hear told better. And I think that the brands with the huge platforms in this room can start telling better. One, everyone talks about the possibility of a better future, but who's showing it? Who's taking us into that magic world and showing us that future that we can create? Everyone's talking about trying to do that. I haven't seen anyone jump forward and bring it out there. Brands need to start doing this, showing us what our lives can be if we take action. The good life. There's already so many rumblings, and the story of stuff helped me see it, bring it forth, that consumerism and consumption and more is not a path to happiness. What does a life of true contentment look like? How can we tell stories and drop people who haven't considered that possibility into that new myth? Oh, one of them got lost. And okay. And then the other story is to follow me on Twitter, which is another great story. So, the third story is really about a new relationship between corporations and citizens. What are we asking our audiences to do that is meaningful, and how can we create these feedback loops and cycles where we're hearing them and we're actually partnering with them, recognizing this new social media world is all about partnership, telling stories about how they can plug into the story and help write ours. So teaching a workshop for an hour later today if you guys want to actually learn how to start doing this stuff and creating these new myths for the new future. Thanks so much.